numbers people. They're just chasing historical numbers all the time. They're not growing their business. They don't know how to sell. They don't know how, really don't really know how to talk to clients very well. And I love architects, and I need an architect. Obviously, an accountant and an architect if I'm building a house. But there's a whole education missing there. And it's good for me because I get parachuted in to help fill that education. But I see people invest so much time and energy, and just it's off track, and it's a great shame. And some of them won't make it back. I worked with Ryan, and I think he was a rescue. We rescued Ryan and brought him back, and now he's passionately back involved with a real dream and a tangible dream because he's filled some of that gap. Education gap that was needed to run a successful business. So, absolutely. And I see the large firms have obviously brought in help. They've brought in professional managers, they've brought in professional finance people, they've brought in a CEO. And so the business acumen and the business skill is brought in at a large expense, but by now they can afford that. But for those smaller practices, that's where they do their stuff. But speaking to people who know a lot more about that than I do.
Thank you. I concur with everything that's been said, and I think, architects are driven, passionate people, often very interested in design, and I think there's probably, there is a sense of entitlement probably with lots of architects that actually I can set my own business up, other people do it, why shouldn't I?
Yeah.
And I think, as I'm involved quite a lot in the food business at the moment, I use the analogy of a restaurant. If you're a restaurateur and you were going to set up a restaurant, you need some serious funds behind you. You'd have to rent your space, you'd have to fit it out, you'd have to hire chefs, you'd have to get your menu together, and you'd have to really, so that the day you opened, you were kind of ready for business.
Yeah.
Because if you're not, you're dead in a week. There's, very rarely do architects ever approach the project of designing their own business, as you say.
Yeah.
I certainly didn't, and I don't think I know any other architects who've actually really done that. And I think that's kind of where the industry is falling down at that very first hurdle, that kind of sense of entitlement on, I should be able to set my own practice up and I want to, but actually you do have to kind of plan for it, and it is a responsibility, it's a business. And I very much, we've been talking about it just beforehand, I think, the whole industry has been kidding itself. We've been undercharging, underpaying ourselves. As you say, it's kind of broken, and it's broken at a fundamental level.
Yeah.
Because we're giving away services. So, I'm involved in lots of groups, and we're all talking about it, about how we can make a difference and raise our fees gradually. But I think when things are as bad as they have been, it's really difficult to change things quickly, but it's going to take a industry-wide sort of concerted effort to make a difference.
Yeah. And what do you think is at the heart of our practical aspects of running a business or engineering?
I think as other panel members have said, it's almost a kind of fear or actual worry that you're somehow going to be tainted if you're involved in development or the money side of things. But I think architects have to be honest, like buildings cost a lot of money and money is involved in it. And if we don't control it and take control of our situation, we talk about profit for purpose, using, making a profit, but optimizing profit, not maximizing it.
Mm.
So we're making enough money, but we do the things that we set out to do as a practice. So I think it's really, really important to the architects change that mindset and actually start, realizing that money is the kind of oil that greases the machine.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, totally. That kind of financial literacy, which is I always find it quite strange that our education, we would go for 7 years of learning about building and design, and architects are amazingly good at dealing with all these other constraints in the built environment, but yet the economic forces, which are the kind of forces that really defines our built environment, somehow remain a mystery at times. How can we start to learn about that? How would you